Marine diesel engines designed for saltwater have two water pumps with a heat exchanger between the two designed to exchange energy without mixing fluids. In part one of this video set, we removed a leaking Yamnar freshwater pump, we decalcified the heat exchanger, and we inspected the exhaust elbow that mixes efferent saltwater with hot exhaust. In this part two video, we'll install the new freshwater pump, we'll pressure test and burp the system, and we'll look at design features of these intriguing little engines. I've got the old pump here, and I want to explain to you how it works. This is a typical centrifugal pump, a water pump. It draws the cool fluid from the heat exchanger in this port here and sends it out that port. It rotates clockwise. Fair enough. When you look at it from behind, it rotates counterclockwise. Fluid from the intake of the pump comes in the center of the pump, back deep in behind there, and flings it outward to go out this way. But what's this here? What's this hole right here? You see, there's a hole that's contiguous with the intake of the pump, and it's a little bypass hole. What's the point of that? So this is the bypass track that allows you to bypass the heat exchanger when the engine is first warming up, when it's really cold. Of course, the number one goal of a cooling system is to cool the engine, but the number two goal and the first goal is to allow the engine to warm up very quickly, because the amount of wear that happens in an engine is right at the very beginning. That's when it's most vulnerable to wear, when it's cold and when the oil is thick and sludgy. So you want the engine to warm up to operating temperature as soon as possible. And the way they do that is that when the engine is cold, instead of fluid going to the heat exchanger, the fluid that's in the heat exchanger is actually sequestered and is not heated. And instead, the coolant from the engine goes immediately back into the engine through this bypass tract. And that allows the engine to warm up very quickly. Right, let's talk about what we've got here. This is the water pump, and this is the water pump bracket. And interestingly enough, the alternator mount's on here as well, so it's also the alternator mount. Now, cold water is drawn from the heat exchanger in through the pump here and sends it out here to the engine. We've got a few other devices here. This is the coolant temp sensor right here. It feeds the gauge that tells you what the temperature of the engine is. And this fitting here attaches to a heater that goes to heat our hot water, so we have hot water out of our taps. If I turn it around here, our thermostat is under here, and right now, because it's cold, that thermostat will be closed. But when the hot coolant comes from the engine, it comes in through here and goes into that cavity. And if you look deep inside there, I think you can appreciate the very end of the thermostat. And right now the thermostat is closed, and so coolant can't get to the heat exchanger. But what it does do is it feeds the bypass channel, and the bypass channel enters here, goes along this tract, and feeds this hole. Now at this point, a lot of guys would change out the thermostat. I'm not going to do it today, but it'd be easy enough to do. You'd take off these two bolts, lift it off, there's a gasket, and the thermostat comes with it easily. That would be easy to do later, if and when needed. Notice the paper towel here. I have stuff in here so I don't get any debris into the system. This is a carbide scraper, especially designed for this exact process. You have to be really cautious if you've got aluminum here, because you don't want to gouge the surface. This is brake clean. It's getting all the grease off. So here are my part numbers. I've checked out this gasket and it fits perfectly. This says 2GM, but I think it'll fit the 3GM. I've trial fitted and it's fine. Notice it's got a bit of a complex twist in it. When I tried a generic pipe, it formed a bend, and that'll be a constriction, so that's no good. So I'm going to use this high tack. I must say, this always makes me nervous, because with two gaskets, my chance of failure is twice as high. And I'll direct your attention to this little nick here. I don't know if you can see that. That has me quite concerned. Right there. I don't know how that happened. It's not all the way through. But in any case, there's a lot of debate about the issue of RTV in these. Most experts say you should not use RTV with a paper gasket, and so I'm not going to use RTV. We'll use this high tack and see what happens. Now I've got them both hanging with the coat hanger, and we'll let them dry. It takes about 10 minutes generally. While we're waiting, I'm going to blow out these bolt holes with canned air. just to make sure there's no debris in the hole that'll give a problem. And I put a little bit of thread sealer on the threads themselves just to try and prevent it from sealing. I was going to use this PTFE, but it's dried up on me. It's nice and tacky. This one short bolt we can do up now. I'm going to put a little silicone paste on these connections here. Okay, now let's give it a go. Just putting these on finger tight. I've checked the connection, it seems to be okay. I put the hoses on first because I think they'll be really hard to get on after. Star pattern here. I switched to a torque wrench for this, just for this last bit. That's 10 foot-pounds. The manual calls for about 5 or 6, which I think is too low. All right, second pass, I'm going to do 15 foot-pounds here. Now before it dries, I'm going to strap on the alternator and put the belt under some tension. The reasoning being, since the bracket is under tension, I want it to be under tension when it dries and sets into place. These alternators come with mounting bushings, and it turned out this one ended up with a little defect in it, so I had to take it off, take it back to the anvil, pound it back into shape. I think it'll be good now. So here are the connections to the alternator, and I made the job easier for myself because I took a picture of it, a little video with my camera to show me where all the wires go, and I taped them all together so they wouldn't get lost. Basically three connections, there's this connection here. Just have a look at the connections and make sure there's no corrosion. That goes in there. The ground connection is here, and I had 4 wires onto that, all pretty much the same color. Usually they're black, and I had 3 red wires all connected down here to the positive post. I'm going to start the process with deionized water and transfer it into a bucket to get the volumes right. I'm going to start with 1.5 liters of this. Now, a professional workflow would never allow you to let things sit overnight, but I decided to do it in this one in part because of the difficulty, the question mark about that one gasket. I wanted the high tech to completely dry up before exposure to water. Okay, now after adding the water, I'm going to do a pressure test in the system. Now I've got at least 2 kits designed to pressure test cooling systems, and the tricky issue is that they all have different adapters. Fortunately, the Yamnar one is fairly standard, so let's see what our pressure does. Okay, it's been a couple of minutes, about 9.5 psi at the moment. Very slight leak, but you know that leak could easily be from the system itself, from the adapters, either at the cap here or elsewhere. So this is the coolant I'm using, designed for diesel. It's got some antioxidants, low silicate, low phosphate, and amine free. Now my seacock is closed, and so I'm going to siphon some plain water into the intake for the saltwater impeller so the saltwater impeller doesn't have to start dry. All right, siphoning.
I've opened the seacock. We're running now. Our fluid level is right up the pipe here. You can see it. So now I'm going to run the engine until the thermostat opens. So far I don't see any leak. So this is a spot where you can really mess up, because you don't want to run the engine with air pockets in the system.
Isn't that a wonderful sight? Honestly, it's not much different than it was before I did the cleaning, but
I'm a lot more confident now that everything is okay here.
I can feel a little warmth now, and so the thermostat is at least partially open, and you can see some air bubbles coming through every moment or so. You can see a little bit of the high pack there, but I don't see any evidence of coolant at all. Down low.
I've just shut the system down, and now I'm going to put the cap back on to allow the most important phase of this burping procedure to happen overnight. I've put a little bit of silicone paste onto the gaskets, and this is the silicone paste that I'm talking about. You can get it through Amazon. Not as easily available through auto parts stores. Some of them are colored or have generic labeling, but in any case, this is a clear silicone that never dries, and it's very useful in this situation. Now, for those of you who don't know how this works, that's the reservoir bottle there. You can see the reddish fluid is just below full. And there's a tube that goes below the level of that fluid and comes all the way back here to end up here, just above the valve for the thermostat. Now, as the engine cools down tonight, what will happen is any residual air pockets that are present in that system will shrink. And as they shrink, the pressure inside the system will drop below atmospheric pressure, which will pop open the little valve here, and it'll siphon fluid from the reservoir all the way back into the engine. And of course, just like a straw, any tiny pinhole leak in the system can mess it up. And so you need to look very carefully at the seal here and elsewhere, make sure everything is hunky-dory, because this siphon system relies on that to work properly. It's wise to take the cap off and recheck fluid levels in the coming days just to make sure that there's nothing wrong. Okay, I'm going to shut it down there. The next time I do this job, I'm going to get some hoses and make up some adapters so I can pressure test the system underwater on the bench before I put the heat exchanger back onto the boat. Otherwise, it seemed to work just fine, and overall, I'm happy with how things worked out. Let me know if I earned your like today. Thanks for watching.